expressed here since 1848, and the way our lives have been affected, enhanced and changed through our presence in this building. But we recall that we are God's building. We are responsible for witnessing to the faith and for living a Christian life. And so we reflect on the ways we have failed, but we open our hearts to the immense, undying, overflowing love of God as we confess our sin.
Amen. Oh. extraordinary, because the temple of God is sacred, in you are that temple. The word of the Lord. Only work
reasons, I think. First, because of the passion, conviction, and devotion of those who designed and built them. The conviction of Father Wagner, who promoted and practiced the Catholic faith here in the 19th century, in the face of immense opposition, making this place a place of prayer and community. The devotion and insight of R.C. Carpenter, whose design won plaudits from the growing desire for authentic architecture in the 1840s, and the artistry of G.F. Bodley, who designed the narthex and the majestic rood. The foresight of Father Milburn, who adapted the building for modern worship without destroying its character. Second, these buildings really work because they are home to communities, because they are prayed in, because the sacred liturgy is celebrated in them, they acquire an atmosphere. Often there is a stillness in these places that persists even when the sound of the traffic can still be heard, and the sirens and the sound of people shouting in the streets. It's an urban thing, and thank God we have it. Our open churches, which provide an oasis of stillness in a busy world. All of this can be so. All of this is so, because here heaven and earth meet in the eternal now of the sacred mysteries, and because we gather around the altar to celebrate and to make present the eternal verities on which our tradition is founded. We are God's building. Christians are only really called to do two things: to worship God and to build community, in that order. It is not always true that individual Christian communities manage to do both. Either they focus on the worship of God and shut the rest of the world out, or they launch out into a waiting world with nothing to offer but soup kitchens. What I remember from my earliest days as a churchgoer is the importance attached to sales of work. These went on for days, and throughout the year people bought coupons to spend at the sale, where they could buy shoddy goods at inflated prices, all for the good of the church. There were socials too, and potato pie suppers. All these events were well attended, but hardly anyone ever went to church. When John Moore, later Bishop of Ripon, was rector of Holy Innocents Fallowfield in South Manchester during World War II, he was visiting a woman in the parish who said she belonged to Holy Innocents. He expressed delight and said that he hoped she found the services helpful. "Oh, I don't go to services," she said, "but I have been to two whist drives." Mormon's response was almost unprintable. Churches with a highly developed devotional and liturgical life often suffer from the opposite problem. They can so easily turn their back on the world and create a holy huddle that is difficult for anyone from outside to penetrate. I'm sure some of you will be familiar with the speech of Bishop Frank Weston in his concluding address, Our Present Duty, at the Anglo-Catholic Congress in 1923. It was a rallying call to the movement which at the time felt itself poised to take over the Church of England. self-sacrifice and discipline. But above all, it was a reminder to the movement of the primacy of the bishop, the recognition that Christ came for all, died and lives for all. He ends. You have got your mass, you have got your altar, you have begun to get your tabernacle. Now go out into the highways and hedges, where not even the bishops will try to hinder you. Go out to look for Jesus in the ragged, in the naked, in the oppressed and sweating, in those who have lost hope, in those who are struggling to make good. Look for Jesus, and when you see him, gird yourselves with his towel and try to wash their feet. Half times changed. You see, as the prophet Jeremiah pointed out, you can't stand at the temple, the dwelling place of God on earth, feeling safe if you are not prepared to proclaim and live the conviction that lies at the centre of your tradition. We all fail in this, and very few, if any of us, will be capable of standing on street corners and proclaiming our faith. And I know, I cringe when I have to join the Palm Sunday procession, even when it only means walking round the block and scuttling back into the church. But much of our outreach is hidden and normal and routine. For those of us who welcome visitors to our church, it will be a one-off encounter, the chance to say a kind word of welcome, a smile. And we'll never know to the full the good we have helped to bring to a person's life when they pass through our doors. By now, they may well be back in Peru or Poland, China or Russia or Carlisle. But we will have played a part in their pilgrimage and perhaps reminded them that God is love and desires them. This place, the open door, the fine building, our liturgy, our music, our communal life, are all vital evangelistic tools held in balance. They all help in their own way to proclaim the gospel. But lose the balance, begin to venerate this place as if it were God, and you are lost. We are all lost. It is a means and not an end. If it speaks at all, if we speak at all, the only word must be of the living word, Jesus of Nazareth, who out of love for us poor sinners became flesh and is with us on our pilgrimage today. pray together to God our Father. In thanksgiving for the witness of this holy place, to the undying love of God, to almost a century and three quarters, for all those who have ministered here as priests and lay people, for the way in which our own journey of faith has been enhanced in this place. We pray for the continued mission and future of this Christian community. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For the world which God so loves, for our willingness to approach it, for those who live with the reality of conflict, for those whose lives are under threat from deprivation of any kind, from oppression. We pray for our own country, for Elizabeth, our Queen, and her government, and for all those who take decisions that affect our lives. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For our families, friends, neighbours and colleagues. For all who live and work in this locality. For those who visit this city. For all in sickness or distress at this time. Who are part of this community but prevented from being here with us today. May they feel the support of our prayer and the healing power of God's love. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For those who have died, for the ending day in Amos, brutally murdered on Friday, all those who have worshipped Almighty God in this place before us and are now departed this life. For Father Wagner, for all the priests who have served here, and for all the worshippers who through the ages have witnessed to the immense love of God. Rest eternal grant unto them, O Lord.
And may I be blessed.
May they rest in peace.
Amen.
We join our prayers with those of our patrons, Paul, and all the saints, as we acclaim Mary, the ever Virgin Mother of God.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Silence, let us bring our own prayers to the Father. Merciful Father,
accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Thank you.
Christ, which is both yours and mine, may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
Oh.
sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." He gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
gracious and grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, have mercy.
O God, who choose to foreshadow for us the heavenly Jerusalem through the sign of your church on earth, grant, we pray, that by our partaking of this sacrament, we may be made the tent of your grace and may enter the dwelling place of your glory, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Be seated, please. And welcome to our visitors this morning. There will be a lunch afterwards, and obviously only those who have booked for lunch will be able to receive it. We'll be in the Wagner Hall, which is next door to this building. You go out to the main entrance, turn right, and continue to turn right, you'll eventually find the entrance. There will be Mass in church on Tuesday, Wednesday, and Saturday this week, and of course at 11:30, and of course next Sunday, as usual, at 11 o'clock. Could I draw your attention to the notices on the inside of the Mass book today, with a list of various fixtures and a reminder about the Christmas draw on the 12th of December. Please stand. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Mass is ended. Go forth in peace. We may be brought unto the glory of his resurrection, through the same Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.